In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We gather together,
all who would serve the living God.
Christ has called the nations and sent us to redeem.
Christ walked among us and was found perfect in the eyes of God.
In Christ, God's holy word was made holy, and those
who turn to God. Then let us carry the good news to all the nations to hear.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Let us remain standing. Our first hymn is number 3, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Some announcements this morning. First of all, the flowers that are on the altar are placed to the glory of God and in honor of Candace Carpenter's 40th birthday this week. So, and another blessing that we have this week, the rosebud that is on our organ this morning is in honor of Tate Davis Trexler, who was born on Friday to Amanda and Cody Trexler at 4:20 p.m. And so Frank and Wanda have another grandchild, so we are happy to see that. After church today, following worship, we will have a Board of Christian Education meeting. Then consistory will be tonight at 6, and choir practice will be Wednesday at 7. Is there any other announcements this morning?
Yes, Kate?
George will be in the conference room. Okay, Lord will be in the conference room. Oh, yes, Jane.
For all consistory members, please pick up your packets after church. There's a lot in it this week.
Okay, a lot of your consistory packets, so get those today. Turning our attention to our prayer list for a few minutes, some updates. Diane McAllister is in the hospital this week and having some heart problems, so prayers for her. Also, Linda Holt is having eye surgery this week, so keep her in our prayers. And Alan Hathcock has had a little bit better week, but he is currently in surgery this morning, so continued prayers for him because he does have a long still recovery. Is there anyone else to lift up in prayer this morning? Not then, let us go to God in prayer.
Almighty God, as we start our day in your house of worship, we are so thankful that you are with us. We are so thankful, O God, that we have been made in your image. There are many times that we do not live as we should. We put our wants first and foremost instead of asking what direction you would have us to go. Oh God, we at times do that. Yet, even when we fall short of your glory, and the scripture says that all have fallen short, you lift us up, you encircle us, you bring us back into the fold, and for that we are so grateful. We are thankful that you sent Jesus Christ to walk among us. This morning we celebrate joys in the life of our church family. We also lift up to you in prayer those who are sick and need healing. And we are so thankful, O God, that that healing comes from your mighty hands, that you are God with us. Thank you for sending your Son Jesus Christ, that he walked among us, that we might have life eternal. We lift up to you today these friends, relatives, loved ones, and ask that you would heal them, for healing comes from your mighty hands, O God. Give us your Spirit. Give us your direction this day. Help us not to rebel, but to press forward in the service to your kingdom that you would have us to perform. We thank you for the many people that make worship possible, who work hard, not for recognition, but in service to you, O God. We thank you for your presence among us this day. And as we are gathered here, we are reminded that the love that we have from Christ, from you, your Holy Spirit, and the love that we have from this congregation, help us that we might support you better and to a fuller extent. We thank you for your presence, and we ask, O God, that you would be with us now. And we pray as Christ Jesus taught us to pray,
saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
At this time, I'd like for the elders and deacons to come forward to be installed. And I know Sonia is sick and not with us, but if the rest would come forward, I would appreciate it. beloved in the Lord, these persons that stand before you have been chosen by you, this congregation, St. Matthew's Reformed Church, to take part as elders and deacons in the service of this church. They have accepted your call. No one has come forward to urge any just objection to them being set in their office. I therefore proceed in the name of the Lord to set apart each of you in your own office to the work of the ministry among us and in your behalf. Sisters and brothers, it is a great honor to bear office in the Lord's house. It is also a solemn trust which no one should take lightly or rashly. For although your election has been by free choice of your fellow members, you're not to regard yourselves merely as servants of humankind, but servants of Christ. You therefore should magnify your office and account of its duties as service to be rendered unto God and not simply to each other. Elders are appointed to support the minister of the word and the general government of the church. They form with the minister and each particular charge a council in common for the spiritual supervision of the flock, which is committed to their care. They are the advisors and counselors to the ministers in the discharge of this holy office. They are to be to him the eyes and hands, acting with him and for him, representing his presence through the congregation. It is their providence to go before the flock in the way of Christian example, to watch over it in the Lord, to take an active interest in its spiritual welfare, to feel a responsibility for its condition and be at its hand in all circumstances. To them, moreover, in conjunction with the pastor, belongs the whole discipline of the church and its powers of the keys as exercised in both the form of censure and the form of restoration. Deacons are to support the pastor in these ministrations which pertain to the more outwardly needs of the general household of faith. They aid in the securing funds for the support of the church and its various activities. They are to labor among the people in making known the needs of the church, fostering principles of stewardship, and thereby cultivating the spirit of liberal and cheerful giving. In discharging these duties, however, they must not lose sight of the true spiritual characteristic of the office. Although it may be outwardly occupied with temporal things, yet it may remain a proper branch of Christian ministry, requiring virtues and merits of like sort, which are needed for the office of the ministry in its more exalted character. Having considered the nature and designs of these offices to which you have been called by voice of this congregation, do you accept the calling from God, and do you undertake the work and service that sets before you in the name for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ? If so, answer,
I do.
Do you recognize the Holy Scriptures and the New Testament as the Word of God and the ultimate rule of Christian faith and practice?
I do.
Do you promise to exercise your ministry as elders and deacons among this people with faithful diligence according to what you've now declared to be the rule of your faith, showing proper regard for the church and taking heed of your own lives, that all may know the gospel of our Savior through walk in the place of this place, the church of the living God? If so, so I do. And Brother, I install you into the office of deacon. May God be with you and support you and encourage you. Madonna Goodson, I install you into the office of elder. May God go with you and support you and encourage you. Robert Cameron.
asking, I ordain you to the office of elder. May God go with you and support you and encourage you. Let us pray together. Almighty God, we
thank you for these individuals who have come before you that are willing to make sacrifices, who are stepping up to the plate in service. We thank you for them, but we thank you for the support of this whole congregation. And we ask this day that your Spirit would dwell upon St. Matthew's Church, that you would fill us with a zeal and service for yourself through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This time, I'd like for the children to come forward for the children's message.
Good morning.
How are y'all?
Good. Okay, so we're going to talk about baptism today. Do you know what it means to be baptized?
No.
No. Okay. Well, good. And I'm going to tell you what it's like. Okay, so over here behind Kiever, that we use sometimes when a baby comes into the church and the parents decide that they want to baptize the baby, you'll see them. We're going to pretend this is my baby. It's a who?
It's a Lego man.
It is a Lego man, but he's going to be the baby today because I don't have any little toys, so I had to borrow one. Okay, so they will fill that up over there, and they'll fill it up with water. And the parents will come up here with the baby. And what they're doing is they're telling the church and they're telling their friends and family that we're going to raise this baby in church, and we're going to try our best to do what's best for this baby. So they're going to take some water, and they're going to sprinkle it over the baby, okay? Now, in Baptist churches, they have called a baptismal pool. And sometimes you see it's like a pool, and it's behind back there, and they take the baby, it's usually an adult or a child. And that's when they decide that they want to follow Jesus and that they take that commitment, and they're going to follow Jesus, and then they get dunked, okay? Because that's what he did. He just got dunked. And so they're saying that they're going to follow God, and they're going to come to church every Sunday, and they're going to come to Sunday school. But the people out in here in the congregation, they also play a part in it. What do? They tell that they're going to commit, and they're going to help raise you guys too. And some of them are going to be your Sunday school teachers. Some of them are going to be your vacation Bible school teachers. Some of them are going to help with the Christmas play. And they're going to try to raise you the way God would want you to be raised. Well, today in the scripture, we're going to learn about a guy named John the Baptist. Now, he was baptizing people in a river. And Jesus comes to John the Baptist, and he wants to be baptized. Well, why did Jesus want to be baptized? He didn't have no sin. But you know what? He wanted John the Baptist to baptize him because he wanted to receive a blessing also. So he's letting us know every time someone gets baptized, it is a blessing. So if you'll listen to the pastor's sermon today, that's what he's going to talk about. And today I got you some fruit snacks. So I tried to get you something quiet to eat.
Thank you.
and sisters who are part of God's church, let us join together in confessing our sins before Almighty God. Lord, so often we have failed. The good news of Jesus Christ promised in the gospel to all who repent and believe. As I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but the wicked turn from their ways and live. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. Lesson today comes from Isaiah, the 42nd chapter, the 1st through the 9th verses. Here is my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break. A smoldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged till he establishes justice on earth. In his teachings the islands will put their hope.
This is what the God, the Lord, says. The creator of heavens, who stretches them out, who spreads out the earth, with it all that springs from it, who gives breath to its people and life to those who walk on it. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people, a light for the Gentiles, to open the eyes that are blind, to free the captives from prison and release from the dungeons those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not yield my glory to another or praise to idols. See, the former things have taken place, and the new things I declare. Before they spring into being, I will announce them to you. Sanctify us through your words. Your words, your truth, O Lord. Join with me now in confessing our faith before Almighty God.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the wicked and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, and life everlasting.
As we've been blessed by the hands of the Almighty, let us return a portion of those gifts back to his hands. Our gifts of our tithes and offerings upon your altar. Use these gifts, multiply them for the upbuilding of this church and for your kingdom upon this earth. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, we pray. Amen. from our gospel lesson, 13th chapter of the third chapter of Matthew's gospel, the 13th through the 17th verses. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me?" Jesus replied, "Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this, to fulfill all righteousness." Then John consented. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And the voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." The Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Draw near, my Lord, and be not the crowd.
Today's text, the gospel, is on the baptism of Christ. And in this account, Jesus comes to John the Baptist to be baptized. And there's a lot of ways that this particular message can go. But this signifies the beginning of Jesus' earthly ministry. This starts the journey where he will then be preaching and teaching. In Matthew's account, we've had the wise men who came, followed by the ministry of John, and now Jesus' earthly ministry begins in earnest with his coming to John the Baptist. I appreciated in this morning's children's message talking about baptism. In some ways, I think it's something that we understand well. And in other ways, maybe we don't think of the full ramifications of baptism and the importance of what it is and the fact that it is symbolically reminding us that Jesus wipes our sins away, but it's also anointing of the Holy Spirit. See, baptism is not just simply symbolic. It is the Spirit. Just like with the installation of our consistory officers, we are calling upon God to send His Spirit upon us so that we might be in His service, that we might do all we can. One of the things that I think is so important that we as the church need to remember is do not underestimate the power that you have for doing good and influencing others. I share this story from time to time, and I can't remember if I've shared this or not at St. Matthew's. But growing up, I was a frequent visitor to the White House. And I know some of you are probably shocked at how someone like me was a frequent visitor to the White House. However, you're probably thinking of the more famous one in Washington. But the White House that I visited was the home of Virginia White, who was my Sunday school teacher and happened to be the neighbor of my grandma. And so periodically on a Sunday afternoon when we were out at grandma's, I might run over to Virginia's for just a little while and visit. And she was always welcoming and encouraging and supporting me. In fact, one of the reasons I believe that I'm in the ministry today is because of the influence of my home church and the pastors and the people that encouraged me as such. Years ago, I got to go with my grandparents to a wedding in Pennsylvania. And one of my granddad's cousins told him, now if you're going up there, you need to take that boy by the seminary and let him look around. Granddad, who's always interested in driving just a little further, was more than willing to go out of his way for that sort of thing. And so we have multiple focuses around the church. There is the spiritual thing, that we cannot do this that we do without God's Spirit upon us. However, all of us can influence and work for the good of God's kingdom. You know, one of the things, I like a lot of stuff about this church, but I am not naive enough to think that this is a perfect church with perfect people. I don't believe that at all, but I see a willingness to work, a willingness to accomplish things, a willingness to serve others that is a refreshing part of this world. And today we remember our own baptism. Most of us were probably who grew up in this tradition, at least, don't remember baptism. I was baptized as an infant. I have no recollection of that day. In fact, yesterday I thought it was very interesting. Charlotte and I went to a birthday party of a friend of hers. And when this little girl was born, she spent some time in the Baptist hospital. And I saw her yesterday, hadn't seen her for a year, and was so amazed at how she had shot up. And I said, I remember seeing you as an itty-bitty baby when you were in the hospital. And she said, I don't remember that. I wasn't expecting her to. However, I remember it. And I think it's important that we know that God's Spirit is with us. And what happens in this moment when Jesus comes up out of the water? It says that the voice came from heaven. Well, first of all, heaven opened, and they saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on Christ. And it is in this moment that the voice from heaven says, "This is my Son, whom I love, and with him I am well pleased." God loves Jesus because Jesus is his Son. However, something to remember is that we have been grafted into the tree that is Christ as Christians. And the Bible teaches us that we are heirs, co-heirs with Christ. That we are not outsiders. We are not people who are in-laws and outlaws of the church or whatever it is. We are the children of Almighty God. And the love that God has for his one and only Son is as strong as he has for us. And that is a powerful love. Because we love the people who love us. You know, that's our natural inclination, is to show love to the people who return it back to us. Because you know, a very hard thing to do is to show love to someone who doesn't appreciate it. It seems like, you know, you show love and someone reciprocates it, and it's easy that way. But God loves us before we were even born. God loves us when we are in our best moments, when we're sitting here in church worshiping him. God loves us when we're doing other things, maybe things that we're not so proud of, and yet the love of God remains the same. And so this is what I've been thinking a lot about this week. We have these wonderful prophecies of the Old Testament about the servant of the Lord. But we too are God's servants. And we can do a lot for the kingdom of God. But we need to be willing to serve as best as we're able. And there are no important and unimportant ways of serving. Everything in service to God is important. Because I believe that this church isn't as big as it could be. I believe there are more people in this community that we can reach. I believe there are more people out there that we can help. I believe that there is more people that we can pray for. And one of the things that I have seen about this congregation is it is a spiritual congregation that prays and supports and shows love. And that is a wonderful thing, and there is no end to that. I've got some great possibilities in mind. There's things that I think of at night and in the morning and at different times at the hours of the day. Abby will tell you probably one of the most mind-numbing, irritating things about me. Yeah, don't you like how I preface that? See, I'm always thinking about something, but I don't necessarily do it out loud. And something that appears to come from left field has often been well thought of. But see, if we are in line with God, if God's Spirit is dwelling among us, then there is no stopping what we can do as God's people. The excuses are plentiful. We can make 100 different excuses. Some of it is legitimate, and some of it's not. You know, one of the things that I've learned the older I've gotten is that it's very easy to say no when you want to say no. There is always a good reason for not doing it. I applaud the people who have stood forth to come on and serve as consistory, because it is not always easy. Sometimes it is. Sometimes it can even be fun. But there's other times that it's boring, that it's work, that hard or difficult decisions have to be made. And I applaud them for stepping up in service. But the thing is, the consistory is the governing board of the church. That's not all the people that do the work. In fact, the consistory by itself would be utterly useless without the congregation support and backing and lifting up. And it is important that we work together, because what we are doing here is not for our glory. It is not to build up this church, but it is so that the gospel of Jesus Christ may be proclaimed in this community. In fact, sometimes I think that the one thing, I hate to use the word criticism of the church, but maybe I feel like sometimes at least that this church is the best kept secret of this community, because it is a wonderfully supportive group, a group that cares and loves about one another. And so thus, it should not be a secret. It should be something that we proclaim and allow to burn brightly, because the gospel of Jesus Christ is the reason that we are here, to serve Christ and to serve one another. And we need to remember that our own wants are not always right, that we are in service to Christ and others. You know, there are people out there, you know them as well as I do, who are utterly miserable. What I found, the most miserable people out there are often the most inwardly looking people. The people who are most focused on self and what is wrong with their own lives. There's people out there who I wouldn't want to trade lives with, because maybe it doesn't seem as appealing, yet they are so outwardly focused that they have so much joy in their hearts and in their minds. So there is no end to the possibilities of this church. If a church prays together, if a church supports and loves one another, and if a short church is a beacon in the community, we will be successful. What does Jesus say to Peter? Upon this rock I will build my church. And even the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. There is nothing that can prevail against God's people if we have our hearts and minds focused in the right place and they're about His business and not ours. Let us pray together. Almighty God, we thank You for these words of Scripture, the comfort they bring to us and the fact that they challenge us. Help us that we might serve You as best as we're able. We thank You for the fact that we have been made in Your image. Help us to remember that and help us to allow it to guide us. In Your name we pray. Amen. Let us stand for our final hymn, number 747, Sunshine of My Soul. The Holy Spirit rest and abide with each of you, both now and forevermore. Amen.